Hello. Can you hear me? Okay. Hi, I'm Andy Tanenbaum, and I'm going to talk about the design of a reliable and secure operating system, which does not have a lot to do with Java, but my apologies. Our goal is to build a reliable operating system. So let me give you my definition of a reliable operating system. An operating system is said to be reliable when a typical user has never experienced a single failure in his or her lifetime and doesn't know anybody who's ever experienced a failure. Okay. In engineering terms, this might be said something like mean time to failure 50 years, something like that. I don't think we're there yet. Okay. Let me describe what I call the television model. Okay. Step one, you buy the television. Step two, you plug it in. Step three, it works perfectly for the next 10 years. Okay. Now let's try the computer model, especially the Windows edition. You buy the computer, you plug it in. Now we're two-thirds of the way there, right? It's just this little step about it works perfectly for the next 10 years that isn't quite there. First you have to install service packs 1 through 9F, okay? And then you install 18 new emergency security patches that came after 9F. And then you've got to find and install 7 new device drivers because they change every 15 minutes. And then you've got to install the antivirus software. And then you've got to install the anti-spyware software. And then you've got to install the anti-hacker software, the firewall. And then you install the anti-spam software. And then you have to reboot the computer. Okay, but I'm not done. I just ran out of space on the slide. So there's more. Okay, it doesn't work, right? Right. So you call the help desk, and they put you on hold for 30 minutes, typically. And then they tell you to reinstall Windows, which is what you're trying to do in the first place, and doesn't work. Okay. And so that's sort of the normal, typical user reaction is not good. The New York Times had an article I saw, it was a couple of years ago now, that said that 25% of computer users have gotten so angry at the computer, they've actually hit it. Okay. So I don't think this is, so good. Anyway, so the question is reliability important? Okay, that for all of us sort of hackers, you can live with it. Ask your grandmother. Okay, her view is it just work. Why doesn't it just work? And you can give her a long story. I won't tell you what happened with email last night. But it just works was not applicable. Okay. So is reliability important? Well, it's annoying when it does all this stuff, and you may lose some work. But also, you should think about things like industrial control systems in factories, where, if it doesn't work, bad things happen. Electric power grids, if it doesn't work there, very bad things happen. Hospital operating rooms, they really don't like to do reboots in the middle of open heart surgery, banking and e-commerce servers, if that goes down for 10 minutes, the bank gets quite unhappy, and so do the customers. Emergency phone centers for storms and stuff, where they're trying to coordinate things. Control software in cars and airplanes. If that doesn't work, bad things tend to happen. Okay, so the question is, can you make software reliable? You can't do it. Actually, I think you sort of can. And if you don't try, you won't find out if you can do it or not. Okay, the Royal Dutch Academy of Sciences gave me 2 million euros to try to make a reliable software. I said, thank you very much. And then the European Union gave me 2.5 million euros to give it a shot. So I said, thank you very much. Okay, so we tried. Okay, now if we succeeded, not so sure. But the question is reliability achievable at all? This is the world, you can't make things reliable and so on. But actually, systems can survive hardware failures. For example, a RAID can survive a failed disk. So if you have a little RAID box and one of the drives totally flakes out and begins smoking and, the head scrapes the oxide off the disk, you can recover from that because there's redundancy and it knows how to rebuild, pull a drive out, put a new one in, it knows how to rebuild it in real time. So you can survive a total disk failure, okay? ECC memories can survive memory bit failures in the RAM, okay? TCP can survive lost packets. It just, blows a packet, it times out, sends the packet again, okay? So CD-ROMs can correct many errors. I don't know if you've ever looked at the structure of a CD-ROM, but about 3/4 of the bits are error correction bits. So, you know, a 700 megabyte CD-ROM actually has a capacity of 3 gigabytes, and all the extra bits are error correction. There's, you know, a 14-bit number used to represent an 8-bit byte, and there's a 3,000-byte number used to represent a 2,048-byte block, and it goes on and on. Endless error correction. That's why they work so well, okay? Gee, if you can survive hardware failures, surely surviving software failures has got to be easier than that, okay? So I think we need to rethink operating systems somewhat. We need to refocus like the research and work on operating systems, which is what we're doing. We have nearly infinite hardware on current PC machines. And I got started with the CDC 6600, which filled up a room this size. I did a calculation, and the iPad has about 30,000 times more computing speed than the 6600, which is the biggest computer in the world, costs $30 million or so. And it's got 10,000 times more RAM, and it's just like infinite computing power, you know, in an iPad, let alone a notebook or, you know, a desktop computer. So we've got lots of computing power. Why can't we use some of that to make it more reliable, okay? So there's tons and tons of useless features. There's bloat everywhere. You know, I mean, your average bootloader these days is, you know, I don't know, many, many megabytes, if not tens of megabytes. Used to be a 512, you know, byte block booted the computer. Now it's, you know, this big with a gazillion options nobody wants. So current software is kind of big and bloated and buggy, and I really think the direction we need to go is smaller and more reliable, okay? So keep this TV model in mind of, you know, you plug it in, it works. How do we get there? So I think we need software, especially operating systems, that's smaller, because if it's so big you can't understand it, then, you know, I mean, I think Windows is now over 100 million lines of code, Linux is at least 20 million lines of code, you know, BSD is probably in that ballpark. Nobody can understand that much code, and so it's just very hard to get it bug-free. There have been studies showing that there's about one bug per 1,000 lines of code in the very, very best code around. Okay, and it seems to me nobody can get better than that. If you've got a million lines of code, it's 1,000 bugs. Okay, so small modular is very important, so pieces don't affect each other. Aim for reliability, and then as a consequence, you get security. If there's less code, there's less bugs, there's less places you can get into trouble. And I think self-healing, which I'll talk about a lot now, so it should fix its own errors, you know, in the same way that RAIDs fix hardware errors. Okay, here's a brief history of our work. 1976, John Lyons wrote a book about Unix version 6. Okay, AT&T freaked out when they saw this book, and then when the next version of Unix came out, version 7, they put in the new contract that you can't write books about it, you can't teach in classes, it's got to be kept a big secret, so the whole world wouldn't learn about Unix. Okay, it's brilliant marketing on their part. In 1985, I'd been teaching a course using, you know, Unix. Now it's forbidden now. So I decided I'd write a new operating system, sort of like Unix version 7, all by myself from scratch. And I did, and it's a long and complicated history. There'll be an article in Communications of the ASM in March about the history of MINIX, if you're curious. So I started teaching it and wrote a book about it, and then it sort of came out, it became popular and whatnot. Anyway, 1997, we had a second edition that was POSIX compatible. I did that with my co-author, Albert Woodhull. 2000, we changed the license, long story about that, but we changed it to a BSD license. And 2004 is when I got the first of the grants, and then we started making it into a reliable system, okay? And then the third edition of the book came out, also with Woodhull, and then I got the European grant. And then the focus moved a little bit toward embedded systems, which I'll say a bit more. And then we began moving toward NetBSD compatibility a little bit later. So this is sort of the brief history of the thing, okay? So there have been three editions of the book, and the covers get prettier, I think, as you go on. So be it. Okay, let me talk about intelligent design as applied to computers here. I think the idea is to have like a microkernel, which is very small, and hopefully it doesn't have too many bugs. If you have one bug per 1,000 lines of code, 15,000 lines of code means probably 15 bugs. That might be manageable, okay? And Linux is 15 million lines, Windows is 100 million lines. You know, fewer bugs per, you know, same number of bugs per line of code. If you have fewer lines of code, there's fewer bugs, okay? So this is 1,000 lines of code, one bug per 1,000 lines of code that's been observed quite a few times, okay? So we have 15 bugs. Linux maybe has 15,000. They're not all critical. Some may be spelling errors and messages and stuff, but some could be critical. Windows has, you know, vast numbers of bugs, as you all know, and so on. Drivers tend to have, people have studied this, 3 to 7 times more bugs than the rest of the kernel. Nobody ever looks at drivers because, you know, they're just not pretty. You know, students study the memory management algorithm all the time. So that's cool. But nobody wants to look, you know, at the, you know, the HP 2300, 2350 printer driver because it's a mess. And so, but all the code is drivers, you know, so nobody ever looks at that. I think the design should be highly modular, so pieces can't affect each other. And so our design is that the operating system should not run in kernel mode. It should run as user mode processes largely, a little bit of a kernel, and then a whole bunch of user mode processes which are isolated from each other by the MMU, the memory management unit. So step one is isolate the components. So, you know, take all the loadable modules out of the kernel, put them as separate processes, and all the drivers should each run as separate processes. The file system should all run as separate processes. Everything should run as a separate process regarding the principle of least authority, the POLA. So if you don't need access to it, you shouldn't have access to it. So in a standard system like Windows or BSD or Linux, the audio driver is in the kernel, and unfortunately, the audio driver can write on the disk. It's not supposed to, but it has the power to do that. There's no way to stop it, okay? And when we want to make that not possible in our design. Okay, so isolate the I.O., isolate all the I.O. devices, limit the access to I.O. ports if you can, either in hardware and software, constrain the DMA, which you need hardware assistance for. If that's available, use it. Otherwise, do it in software. The next step is to isolate the communication, and then limit the inter-process communication so that different components can only talk to other components when they need to. Again, the principle of least authority. Restrict the kernel calls. The kernel calls are very low-level things like, you know, create a new process shell, a new process, you know, at a very low level. So these are not the POSIX calls. That's at a much higher level. These are the very basic things the microkernel does for process management, interrupt management, and so on. And those things should be done on a per-component basis. If an audio driver doesn't need the ability to create a new process, it shouldn't have it. And if it attempts to make the kernel call to create a new process, it should get an error message back saying, you know, enoperm or something like that, okay? So IPC, pieces can only talk to each other if the kernel approves it. So basically, every time an operating system component tries to do something, it's going to make a kernel call. The kernel then checks to see, is this allowed? So it's got tables and bitmaps and whatnot. If it's allowed, it does it. If it's not allowed, it gives back an error message. Okay, and that restricts the power of all the pieces. Okay, so make sure that a faulty receiver can't hang a sender. So if component A sends a message to B, and B is supposed to, you know, do something, send it back to A, and it doesn't, one piece shouldn't hang the other one. So you get the communication right. We had some trouble with that initially. So here's the architecture of MINIX. It's basically a layered structure. The blue part at the bottom is the microkernel. It handles interrupts, it handles processes, it handles part of the scheduling, although not all of it, and the inter-process communication. That's all. So it knows nothing about file systems, not that much about processes, you know, not all that much about scheduling and so on. Above that, there's a layer here. Little arrow show up. Yeah. Layer of the drivers. Every driver is a separate process. Above that, we've got the servers, which is really the core of the operating system, the file systems, process management, you know, the other things that are sort of operating system-like. And the top are just the regular user programs. Okay, so let me say a few words about user mode device drivers. Each driver should run as a separate user mode process with the MMU turned on, constrained by, you know, the MMU, so it can't get out of its address space, it can't do things that it's not supposed to do. So it doesn't have any super user privileges, they're not, you know, special in some way. MMU is turned on again, so it can't get out of its address space, doesn't have access to the privileged instructions, okay? It doesn't even have access to the I.O. ports. So if the disk driver wants to talk to the disk, it has to make a kernel call saying, here's a list of disk ports, here's a list of values, I'm going to write into them, go write. The kernel first checks, does this process have that permission? If it has the permission, it does it. If it doesn't, it gets back an error. Okay. The user mode servers This is the real core of the operating system. There's each server runs, as again, as a separate process, protected by the MMU, so it can't get out of its little sandbox, as it were. And some of the key servers are, there's the virtual file server, so you can have multiple file systems. There's the actual file servers, there's a MINIX file server, and a couple of others, you know, CD-ROM file server, and other kinds of file servers. There's a process manager, which does the real guts of the process management, not just the very low-level stuff. The memory manager that allocates memory, really, at the very low level, you know, it can like put in a page table, but it doesn't really manage the page tables. That's done by the memory manager. All the network stuff runs in user space. There's a thing called the reincarnation server, which brings back the dead, which I'll talk to you about a little bit later. It's quite important, and so on. So let me give you a simplified example of how read works. So here's the layered structure again, and a user process over here wants to do a read. So it sends a message to the file system, and this little colored thing here, which you can't see very well, that's like the file system's buffer cache. So file system has a buffer cache, and it looks to see if the thing it wants is in the buffer cache, and if it is, it sends a message to the kernel saying, go copy this piece of, you know, cache memory to the user, and then you know, the kernel says, okay, it's done, and then the file system says to the user, it's completed. So, you know, that works very nicely if everything's in the cache, okay? Now let's take a look at the next case where it's not in the cache. So it's a bit more complicated now. The user calls the file system and says, I want to read this block. The file system looks in the cache, doesn't find the block it wants, sends a message to the disk driver saying, go read block number, you know, 217 from the disk. Okay, and then the disk driver makes a call to the kernel saying, you know, start the disk. You know, kernel verifies that it's allowed, makes the call, and then everybody's blocked for the time being. The disk over here eventually is done and sends an interrupt to the kernel. The kernel, at a very, very low level, turns the interrupt into a message. So it's all message-based internally. The message goes to the disk driver, which is now waiting for a message, saying, hi, I'm the disk, I've, you know, I got something for you, okay? The message doesn't actually contain any information other than I'm the disk and something happened. And then the disk driver can read the ports for the disk to find out what happened. If it completed correctly, then it can go back to the file system and say, okay, your disk read is, you know, it's completed. If it didn't complete correctly, it goes back to the file system and says disk error. But either way, the file system knows what happens. The data is now in the file system's cache. The file system can make a call to the kernel saying, please copy it from here to the user mode, to the user process, and then everybody's happy. So it takes a bunch of steps, but it's not that complicated. It's maybe, I don't know, 9 steps or maybe a bit more. These messages take under a microsecond, so we're talking here maybe at most, you know, 9 microseconds or something in that order of magnitude to do the message passing, whereas the disk transfer is going to take, you know, a millisecond or more depending on the nature of the disk. So there's a little bit of overhead, but it's not enormous. Okay? Okay, the reincarnation server is a very important piece. It's the parent of everything, you know, I think it's even the parent of, I'm not sure, of et cetera RC, but it's either the parent of RC or it's started by RC, I forget right now. So basically it starts at the very time the system boots, and it's the parent of all the drivers and all the servers. So there's a hierarchy of the reincarnation server is the parent process of the drivers and servers, and if a driver or a server dies, the reincarnation server hears that its child died, and it, you know, gets to take some action, okay? And it looks into the table what it should do, and typically what it'll do is run a shell script, or something like a shell script, and it'll restart it. And it can restart even the disk driver. Mostly it fetches the new driver from the disk and then just starts it up as a new process. In the case of the disk driver, it can't get it from the disk because it can't get to the disk because the disk driver just died. So we keep a copy of the disk driver in the RAM disk all the time, so it can always get at the disk driver and start a fresh copy so then it can get at the other drivers. Okay. So the reincarnation server also checks the health of the system continuously by pinging things. So the disk driver, so the reincarnation server will say to the disk driver, you know, how you doing? And the disk driver will say, great, I did 69 requests in the last second. And then a little bit later, it pings it again and says, how you doing? And it says, I'm doing great. I did 104 requests in the last second. And then a little bit later, it pings it again and says, how you doing? How are you doing? Okay, I'm going to give you one more chance. How are you doing? Okay, then the reincarnation server assumes it's dead or in a loop or something. It kills it and goes and starts a fresh one, okay? And so a new driver is started because the old one wasn't, you know, obeying the protocol, you know, the ping protocol. And as a result, the system is self-healing. It detects it. It looks, it's constantly checking on its own health. It looks for things that are not, you know, behaving the way they're supposed to, don't follow the protocol. And then, if need be, it starts a new one, you know, to replace the old one. So the system is self-repairing, self-healing. And that really is the way software, I think, has to go. You check your own health. And, you know, when there's a problem, you fix it. That's kind of how the hardware things work also. I mean, with RAIDs and ECC memories, there's redundancy in there. It's checking to make sure everything is okay. And if it's okay, all is well and good. If it's not okay, then, it takes some action to fix it. So the recovery would be like this, okay? So the user sends a message to the file server saying, you know, go read a block. And the file server looks in its cache. And while it's looking in its cache, it steps on a memory error, and, you know, dereferences a pointer, which is zero, and crashes, okay? So the file server disk driver has just died because it stepped on a bad pointer. And the reincarnation server hears that the disk driver died because the disk driver is the child of the reincarnation server. And then it goes and starts a new disk driver and then sends a message to the file server saying, oops, you know, problem with the file server, the disk driver, here's a new one. And then the file server, which has to remember what it was doing, so it's got to have a little table somewhere of, I just sent a message to him, and here was the content of the message, and says, oh, I have to send it again, but now to the new guy. So it sends it again to the new guy, and then the process repeats itself, and we'll try it again. And if that one crashes, you know, that can go on indefinitely. If there was a systematic hard error in the code of the disk driver, so it could never work, then we're toast. I mean, if the driver simply is incapable of reading from the disk, there's nothing we can do about that. Most errors are transient errors. There's some weird timing condition that, you know, somebody tried to do a read the same time there was an eclipse of the moon, and it was on a day which is a prime number, and, you know, all this other transient stuff. And, you know, if you try it again, you don't get the same conditions, and it works. That the really hard errors where the code is simply totally wrong and never works, those are found in the testing typically. It's the errors that don't show up in the testing are the things that depend on very weird timing conditions, races, and so on. So most of the time, if you try it again, it works. Okay? So there's some small possibility. The code is so wrong, it doesn't know what port the disk is on. Well, you know, we can't fix that. But usually that's found in the testing. So we can, in most cases, make the system self-healing by simply starting the bad piece again, okay? Now, there's also some security issues here. There's less code in the kernel. So the kernel, which is really critical, has just fewer bugs because there's less code. You know, one bug per 1,000 lines of code, 15,000 lines of code means sort of 15 errors, sort of, okay? And the kernel is fairly stable. We don't change the kernel a lot. So in due course of time, you know, maybe we can find the errors. In other systems where they're changing this gigantic kernel all the time, they're removing bugs and adding new bugs. As all of you who know about iPads know, there was, you know, iOS 9, which was followed by 9.01, which I think was followed by 9.02, which was followed by 9.1 in the space of about a week, because they used to do testing, you know, back at Apple, and now let the users test it. There's just too much code in there, right? It's gotten, you know, as big as normal desktop system. So small kernel means a smaller trusted computing base. There's no foreign code in the kernel, which is very important. That, you know, for most computers, and not, you know, like iPads and things, but for desktop or notebook computers, when you buy some new peripheral to hook onto it, you get a driver written by some kid in Taiwan whose boss was breathing down his neck. We got to ship it. And the kid says, the driver's not finished. And the boss says, I don't care. We can always put a new one on the web later. So they ship it without bothering to test it, even before it's finished maybe. And that goes into your kernel. Okay, in MINIX that doesn't happen. That the driver code doesn't go into the kernel. It goes into a user mode process where its, you know, reliability and security isn't nearly as important. Okay, we've been very careful about using static data structures. There's no malloc in the kernel, so all the things, you know, malloc and free and memory leaks. There's none of that because there's no dynamic memory. Moving bugs to user space doesn't reduce the number of bugs, but reduces the damage they can do, and that's very important. Okay, so I don't claim we have fewer bugs per 1,000 lines of code than anybody else. It's probably comparable. But they can't do as much damage because they're running as isolated user processes. And so if somebody manages to take over the audio, you know, the audio driver due to some bug in, you know, in the system, and a virus gets in and so on, it can make very strange noises. But when they try to fork off a shell, they'll get back the message from the kernel, you don't have the power to create new processes, and that's the end of it, okay? Okay, security and reliability, fixed length messages, so there's no buffer overruns or any of that kind of stuff. We had a rendezvous system where, you know, A sent a message to B, A blocked, B sent a reply, everything was fine. But we got into trouble then when, if the, you know, client sent a message to a server, and then the server sent a message back to the client, and the client crashed before the answer came back, the server would hang because it couldn't reply. So we had to introduce asynchronous messages, which I don't like, but that was the only way to prevent this kind of a problem. So it's sort of a necessary evil, unfortunately. So there's no lost messages with a rendezvous system, no buffer management, but the asynchronous messages were needed to avoid, you know, one side hanging the other side. Okay. Interrupts and messages are unified at a very, very low level in the kernel. When an interrupt comes in, it's turned into a message to somebody. So the whole system basically is message-based, and interrupts sort of don't, you know, aren't visible even to the kernel, basically. There's a little tiny piece, a very thin layer. Interrupt becomes a message. So inside the system, all you see is message passing, okay? All right, driver reliability. The untrusted code is heavily isolated in user processes. The bugs and viruses can't spread from one module to another easily. They can't touch the kernel data structures, which of course are critical because they're not in the kernel. Bad pointers can only cause one process to crash, which is recoverable in many cases, although not all. Infinite loops can be detected if some kernel, you know, if some operating system piece gets into a loop and doesn't respond to the pings, then the reincarnation server knows that. Okay, there's a restricted power to do damage because they're not super user, and there's some other advantages to user mode drivers too. For example, there's a short development cycle. You know, you put in a driver, you try it, it doesn't work, it crashes, but the rest of the system is still running perfectly well. Okay, it's a normal programming model. You can use debuggers. There's no time for, you know, rebooting the computer and so on. So it's much easier kind of debugging and good flexibility. We ran some fault injection experiments. We injected 800,000 faults into each of three Ethernet drivers. We injected the faults of the binary drivers at runtime. You know, and we made the changes that sort of mimicked programmer errors. So, you know, we swapped the source and destination. We changed, you know, branch less than to branch less than or equal to, kind of errors that programmers typically make. And we inject 100 faults. We waited about 1 second to see if it died. If it didn't, you know, we injected another 100 faults. We just kept going. And we were able to crash the driver 18,000 times. But the operating system never crashed. Okay, so that's the kind of fault injection. We've gone much further on fault injection now. I'll tell you a bit more later. Then at some point we started on the x86. We decided to move to the ARM. And so we had to restructure the whole source tree for multiple architectures, which we had actually with MINIX 1. MINIX 1 ran on a whole bunch of platforms, and, you know, Ataris and Amigas and so on. But most of those sort of died out. So we changed the booting to support the way the ARM boots. We had to rewrite the very low-level code that deals with interrupts and putting, you know, how do you set the page table up and that kind of stuff. The context switching is a little bit different. I don't know, so the x86 segmentation code, which nobody ever used anyway, got rid of that. And we began porting slowly to NetBSD, because NetBSD's big thing is it runs in every platform on the planet. So they're very, very careful about portability. Okay, you have to be very... You know, you can't have inline x86 assembly code in something which is supposed to run on 80 different platforms. So they're fairly careful about being clean. We had to change the tool chain. We used the build.sh from NetBSD, which is very powerful and very flexible. We had to write drivers for some of the Beagle board devices, which I'll mention in a minute. Okay, so we began looking at embedded systems. For example, the BeagleBone Black, that's sort of a very nice open source hardware board, which is about $50. It's about the size of a smartphone, roughly. Okay, and some of its characteristics are: it's got an ARM V7 CPU in it. It's got a clock at a gigahertz, so it's fairly fast. Half a gig of RAM. It's got 4 gigs of flash memory, so there's a little disk, in fact, on the board itself. It's got 1080p video. It's got 92 little pins on it, which you can turn on and off in software. So if your embedded system, you connect them to anything that your larger system needs. It's got the 100 megabit Ethernet on board. It's got a USB port. It's open source, so all the characteristics of the board are publicly available, so you know how the board works. And they're about $45 or $55, depending on, there's a couple of versions of this. Okay. I also just did a comparison to the Raspberry Pi B Plus as an example. It's got an ARM V6, which is an older processor. It runs at 700 megahertz, also got half a gig of RAM. Doesn't have any disk on board, which is a nuisance. It's also got 1080p video. It's got 40 pins, 100 megabit Ethernet. It's got 4 USB ports, which is a plus. So if you need more than one USB port on the BeagleBone Black, you'd need a hub. It's not open source, which is a real problem, because porting it, you can't just download the spec. It's a whole song and dance there. If somebody wants to port MINIX to the Raspberry Pi, I'm all for it, but it was too hard because we didn't have it, and it's a bit cheaper. Okay, so I will admit that I was wrong about something I said a long time ago. Back in 1992, I had a post to the news group, MINIX news group, saying, don't get me wrong, I'm not unhappy. This is just after Linus announced Linux on the MINIX news group. Don't get me wrong, I'm not unhappy with Linux. It will get all the people who want to turn MINIX into BSD Unix off my back. Okay, because there were many people early on who wanted to turn MINIX into BSD, and I was kind of against that because it would require a much more complicated system and students couldn't afford the hardware and so on. So now actually I do want to turn MINIX into BSD, but it just took me 20 years to realize that, so sorry about that. Okay, so MINIX meets BSD. So here's MINIX and here's BSD, and I don't know what we get here or something like that maybe. Just as a note, the BSD daemon is copyright 1998 by Kirk McCusick and used with his permission. He wants me to say that, so I've said it. Okay. Or maybe it's like, I don't know, maybe like this. But anyway, so MINIX has met BSD. You know, why BSD? Well, MINIX didn't have a lot of application software, so, people sort of didn't want to use it. BSD is definitely a proven portable, quality product where, sort of quality software engineering is very high on their list. I think the code quality is much better than Linux. There's a lot of things you can say about the Linux code which are not so clean. Package Source is a very nice package manager. There are thousands of packages available for the Package Source package manager. There's a very active community for NetBSD. License compatibility is a big issue. That we've gone to a BSD license. Of course, BSD has BSD license. Linux has its GPL, which is a religious, kind of thing. I was keynote speaker at a Linux conference in Australia a couple of years ago, and I didn't mention licensing in the talk. Somebody asked me a question after, what license does it have? And I said, it's BSD license. And I was expecting people to throw rotten fruit at me. They began cheering. It's the Linux audience. I was very surprised. But I know somebody used to work for IBM, and they were thinking of putting a lot of money into Linux. And one of the problems the executives had is that they didn't want to spend, a couple of $100 million, supporting Linux and then give all of their stuff to their competitors. But eventually they decided to do that. But it was a difficult decision. So the whole GPL thing is a very controversial thing. But we've gone with the BSD license. So why NetBSD as opposed to FreeBSD? Because of the emphasis on portability. They run on every known platform, which means the code has to be fairly clean. If you're running on all kinds of different architectures, you can't have dirty little tricks involving, some trick instruction that does something really neat on the x86 but doesn't work anywhere else. And so that their code was very, very clean. So we like that emphasis on portability. Okay, some NetBSD features in MINIX. We use the Clang LLVM compiler, which is a very nice compiler done at the University of Illinois. It's a programmable compiler. It's one of the best compilers around right now. We use the NetBSD build system, which again is very, very clean because it's got to work on all these different platforms. We use the ELF file format, which you didn't have before. The source code tree is modeled on the way NetBSD does it, which again has like 80 platforms, so that they've really figured out, there's many ways you can use a 68,000 chip or an ARM V8 chip or whatever. And you know, the tree has been set up to handle all these variants very well. So all of our headers and libraries are taken from NetBSD. Again, it's license compatibility. We have X11. Package source works with about 5,000 packages right out of the box. So at least it compiles. We haven't tested them all, but we can compile about 5,000 packages without errors, and it produces the correct binary and so on. But it's built nevertheless on the MINIX, you know, substructure. Okay, there are some NetBSD things we're missing. We don't have kernel threads. That wasn't there in the beginning. It's very difficult to end it afterwards. Maybe we should have done it, but it would have added a lot of complexity, which I was against. We do have user-level threads, so if some application needs kernel threads, we can't do it. If it just needs threads and it doesn't care whether it's kernel threads or it's user threads, then we can do it. Okay? We're also missing some of the more obscure system calls like LWP and message and SEM. SEM you could probably add easily. We don't have clone. Of course, we have fork, naturally. We're missing some of the GET and some of the strange ioctl calls. We don't have KQ and KTrace, VFork, but that's only a performance thing. We don't have job control. It seems to me if you've got X and multiple windows, you don't need job control. If something's doing something and you want to do something before it finishes, just open a new window. And some other minor calls. It's somewhat exotic stuff that's missing. But most of the basic thing are there. We can build 5,000 packages right out of the box. The QA test, that's sort of the measure of NetBSD compatibility. Now, we ran the testing. 300 tests didn't work. 192 sort of worked but failed. 12 of the failures were expected. We skipped 93 because we knew it wouldn't work. But 2139 of the tests worked. So we're sort of like 80% NetBSD compatible. Okay. So here's the system architecture, you know, the way it is sort of now. So at the bottom, there's the MINIX kernel. There's a little MINIX icon. Then there's the MINIX, you know, drivers. And then there's the MINIX servers, okay? And then there's the NetBSD user land. So we've re-implemented NetBSD user land on top of the MINIX substructure with the reliability and the fault tolerance and the self-healing and so on. So to the user, it looks like NetBSD. But internally, it's got all these MINIX properties of the self-healing and the modularization and the small trusted computing base and so on. So we think of it as sort of the best of two possible worlds. You know, could somebody implement the Linux user land? Possibly. We haven't done that because it's manpower and it's engineering. We're a research university, so it's not research. It's a question of engineering. If somebody wants to do it, by all means, do it. So here's MINIX 3 on the Beagle boards. I mean, you can't read the writing, but basically green is good and red is bad. Okay. We haven't implemented every feature of the Beagle. There's three Beagle boards we've tested it on. The BeagleBone Black, BeagleBone White, and BeagleBone XM. They're similar boards, you know, all about this big. We have most of the things. Some of the more exotic drivers are missing, basically. But for the most part, you know, it works. Okay. So what's your role in all of this? It's an open source project. We had all this funding, but the funding is finished now. So we have no funding at all. So we've become a normal open source project like, you know, thousands of other open source projects. And we certainly hope some of you will join us and help. It's an interesting thing to play with. People who are students at universities could think of using this as a test bed for doing research in reliability and fault tolerance and things like that. So it's a nice little test bed. Some things people could do are, you know, if there's any system calls that are really important, you could add them. You know, we don't like mucking around with the core operating system too much, but if there's something you absolutely got to have, could add that. Certainly you could port more packages. We don't have Java. Not that I think there's any reason, although we don't have kernel threads, but we do have user-level threads, okay? Java would be very nice. We don't have a proper browser. We have Lynx, which is, you know, a text browser. But there are browsers like Firefox is too complicated to port, I think. But there are other browsers like Midori and Dillo and so on. There's quite a few other small browsers out there. Somebody could port one of those. That would be very nice. Midori especially, it looks very, very nice. It seems very simple. A couple of drivers missing for the Beagle boards. A port to the Raspberry Pi would be very nice. There's no technical reason why that should be hard other than the fact that it's not open source and it may be hard to find out how it actually works. But I don't think it's technically very difficult, similar to the Beagle board, basically. RUMP is a project from some guys in Norway about allowing you to use, you know, reuse drivers you know, it simulates sort of the NetBSD environment and allows you to use BSD drivers in a non-BSD environment. That might be interesting. We don't really have a proper GUI. We had one, but we sort of lost it along the way. You need to port a couple of libraries, and then you could probably port KDE or you know, one of the other, you know, GUIs. Okay, so here's MINIX 3 kind of in a nutshell. It's a microkernel re-implementation of NetBSD now. So on the top, it looks like a well-established system with lots of user software and, you know, lots of people who know it well and so on. And inside, it's this microkernel-based thing. It's based on the BSD license. We had a stand at Embedded World in Nuremberg for a couple of years. And a lot of companies came by, and one of the things they all liked was the BSD license. Because they didn't want to, if they're in competitive business, they didn't like the idea of having to give their changes to their competitors. And we had guys who make trains come by, and they said, you know, this train's last 60 years, and we don't know if you're going to be around in 60 years. We don't know if Microsoft's going to be here in 60 years. We don't know if anybody's going to be here in 60 years. We got to have all the source code, you know, got to have no restrictions on what we do with it, and that was really important to them. So it has a BSD license for better or worse. It's compatible with NetBSD. It supports LLVM and also GCC, although the default compiler is LLVM, which I think is a better compiler in many ways. It uses the package source. There are about 5,000 packages it builds, and you can get it at www.minix3.org and try it, okay? So let me say something about the positioning. We're trying to show that multi-server systems can be made very reliable. We want to demonstrate that drivers belong in user mode. We're talking about high reliability, fault-tolerant applications. Certainly embedded systems often have to be highly reliable and fault-tolerant. You know, at some point, there was this $100 laptop project at MIT. At some point, we're going to see a $50 single RAM chip aimed at third world countries, you know, where memory footprint is very important. MINIX is quite small in terms of how much memory it needs. Embedded systems we're looking at, and so on. We have a new feature coming up in 3.4, which is not out yet, but should be out soon. Live update. Okay, software is frequently updated to fix bugs, to improve performance, add new features. Okay, and the goal is to update the operating system without rebooting. You know, if you have to reboot, if a new version of Windows or iOS or Linux or whatever comes out, you got to reboot the computer. Okay, sometimes that's inconvenient. Okay, so we don't want to reboot the computer, and we don't want to interfere with running processes, and we do want to change the operating system. No current system can do this in a reasonable way. And the new operating system may differ from the old one in the sense of it has new data structures internally, okay? And there's a lot of information in those data structures. You know, the kernel or, you know, the file system has got inode tables, and it's got file descriptor tables and stuff. You can't lose that. That's got to be maintained over, you know, an update to the operating system, okay? There's lots of state in there, timers and whatnot. So how this would work? Here's an example of, let's say, Apache running on, I don't know, FreeBSD 10.1, okay? What we want to have is Apache is still running, and now we're running FreeBSD 10.2. So we change the operating system, and Apache is still running, even though we've changed the operating system. You can't do that now with FreeBSD or Linux or Windows. You've got to stop the computer and then restart it. We want to do it without stopping the computer, okay? So we want to replace the operating system while user processes, servers, long-running things are running, and no reboot. Okay, so it's very difficult to do in other systems, and here's how we do it. Okay, so here's, let's say, you know, Apache, for example, is running, and we have all these processes, we have the microkernel, we want to go to a new version of the file system. So we had file system version 6, we're switching to file system version 7, and we want to do this without rebooting anything. Okay, so how do we do this? The manager of the live update tells some process, say the file system, okay, it's time to replace you. You've done a nice job, thank you very much, but you know, you gotta go. So the old one doesn't take on any new work. It finishes all the things it's doing now. So if it's in the middle of various operations and calls from users, it finishes off what it's doing now, but it queues any new incoming work in a table, but it doesn't start on it. But at some point, it's hit equilibrium when it's finished off everything it's doing now, which doesn't take more than a second or two typically, and then it's got all its work queued over, okay? Then it says back to the manager, okay, I'm ready. And then the manager creates a new process, because remember, the file system is just the user process, and puts in the new code of the new file system, And then inside the code of the new file system, placed there by LLVM, the compiler, is a list of all of its data objects. You know, it's got all these tables and variables. It's all put in there by the compiler, which of course knows all about the data structures. And the new one then contacts the old one and says, okay, I need your state. So it transfers the state, you know, file descriptor tables, inode tables, other kinds of stuff, transferred over to the new one. When everything has been transferred over one at a time, it tells the manager, I'm ready, and then a third file system is created. Okay, so they've got three of them running now. And the third one goes to the new one and tries to transfer the state backwards back to the old one using the same update, because it's got a list of its tables too. And then when we've got everything converted back to the old one, they're compared. So if the old one matches the very new one, the third one, we're okay. If it doesn't match, we abort the whole thing, and the update doesn't happen, but nothing is lost, we continue running. It's a little bit like translating English into Dutch using Google Translate, and then translating the Dutch back into the English, you know. And if that works, you know, if the translated English from the Dutch is sort of like the original English, chances are the Dutch was reasonably good or it wouldn't have worked, okay? And it's the same thing here. So graphically, we tell the thing start, we create the new version, version 7. Version 7 says to version 6, I need some variable, gets an answer, you know, goes back and forth until it's got all of its data. Then we create this extra one, this test one. It says, I need variable X. You know, it gets all the state over there. Then we compare, you know, the third one to the original one. If they match, then the update is assumed to have occurred correctly. And then we kill off, you know, the other ones and go with the, you know, version 7. If they don't match, we kill the whole update, continue running the old system all by itself, and everything's fine. There's no update, but the old one continued to run correctly, and there's nothing lost. So this is where we end up, okay? So some of you may know about K-splice, which is a way to patch Linux on the fly, but it only can handle very small security patches. What it does basically is that there's a little bit of code here where there's a branch less than, that should have been branch less than or equal to. It puts a jump over here, just before, you know, changes the branch to a jump over there, makes the other test, you know, the correct test, and it jumps back, okay? So it can only handle very small changes. It can't handle if, for example, a major data structure changed or something like that. So it's a very small security patches, and this can handle much, much more. Also, if the K-splice fails in the middle, you're just toast. The system dies, okay? Over time, all these jumps all over the place accumulate, and you can get a lot of crud in memory, so it's going to fill up memory with stuff. And if the update fails for some reason, there's no recovery, okay? Some other uses of live update, enhanced security. For example, a lot of attacks involve like return to libc or gadgets or things where somebody managed to insert code in which causes the program to jump somewhere, and they put it, you know, in the return address of a function, an incorrect return address, and it jumps to the library or jumps to a gadget and then executes code it's not supposed to do. All those attacks depend upon very detailed knowledge of the memory layout. It's got to know where the stack is and where return addresses are and so on. In our case, and also, you know, we can reduce exposure to memory leakage attacks. In our case, it can't know what the memory layout is because we can update the system at a very high rate if we want to new versions. Okay, so we do a live update to simply a new version for the purpose of making the memory layout different. So we could have a whole bunch of different versions, and it's sitting there every few seconds updating to a new version at random. So an attack that depends upon knowing that, you know, the stack has a certain layout, won't find that layout. Most likely, if it overwrites a word which is not a return address, you'll get a crash rather than, you know, the hacker gets in and can do bad stuff. So it provides much better security. Also, this thing reduces exposure to information leakage attacks because, again, it doesn't know the memory layout. Also, oddly enough, you can do garbage collection in C. You get memory leaks sometimes in C programs because the new version asks for only the data structures it needs. Any garbage floating around, which is not accessible anymore, doesn't get copied over because nobody asked for it. So interestingly enough, we can sort of do garbage collection and fix memory leaks by simply putting in a new copy of the old code and then asking for the variables we need and not asking for the ones we don't need, so the CRUD gets removed. So we do garbage collection even though we're programming in C. Very briefly, some research we're doing in fault injection. The idea is that in the binary, again, LLVM, The LLVM is useful because you can program it. That normally compilers don't put all this information about where the variables are and their types and their sizes and so on in the binary. But because LLVM is programmable, you can write a new pass which simply puts that information, which the compiler has, into memory. So we wrote a new pass to do that. And we also wrote things for fault injection. Basically, every basic block that is a piece of code with one entrance and one exit, we put a test in front of it saying, should we inject a fault here or not? And there's two blocks. The compiler produces two blocks. One of them is the correct one, and one is the faulty one, where we put in some error, okay? And again, this LLVM allows that. So the new program structure replaces every basic block with a series of these little things where there's a test, and then a good block and a bad block, and then it executes either the good or bad one. So at runtime, we can have it, by changing the predicates, have it execute whatever subset of faults we want to inject into the code. So we can easily do fault injection on a very large scale to test the reliability. You know, if you're doing research and you're claiming your system is faster than the old one, it's easy to test that, okay? You just run a bunch of benchmarks and give the numbers. It's very hard to show it's more reliable than the old one. How do you do it? Well, you inject faults. This is a framework for injecting lots of faults in a very efficient way, and we can do that. And the idea is by patching the binary, we can get lots of faults injected and then run lots of fault experiments and so on. We've measured the overhead at something like 8%, so there's a little bit of a hit, but there isn't that much of a hit. Okay, MINIX is a logo. It's the raccoon. Why a raccoon? Well, they're small, our emphasis is on small, right? Raccoons aren't very big, medium-sized. They're cute. Everybody likes raccoons. They look so pretty. They're very smart. They're extremely smart animals. They're agile. They have little hands. And in the U.S., they can open garbage cans, and take out your garbage. They're very, very agile little things. They eat bugs, which is, we think, is a good feature. And they're probably more likely to visit your house than a penguin. Unless you live in Antarctica. We have a website, minix3.org. It's a very simple website. Little story about Minix, and there's a bunch of things you can click on. Learn more, features, fact, resources for newbies, getting involved, news, sort of things you'd expect on a little website. We have a wiki for the documentation, wiki.minix3.org, so you can help document the system. Occasionally we get people say, I'd like to help, but I'm not much of a programmer. What can I do? I said, well, you can maybe write documentation for us. That would be nice. The traffic, the question I get is, does anybody use Minix? We have some various traffic monitors in there, and we're getting hits to the website on the order of, 30,000 hits a month, and this has been going on for probably 10 years. So if you look at the total number of hits since I began tracking it in 2004, we've had 3 million hits to the website, including now probably 30,000 a month ongoing. So we've had 3 million hits. And so for sort of a university open source project, with not very many people working on it, I think it's a reasonable amount of traffic. So there's a lot of traffic. The actual downloads, I began tracking the downloads in 2007, and we've had from the logs 650,000 downloads of the CD-ROM image. The way you get it, you click on some download thing, you get a CD-ROM image, and then you can burn that to a CD and boot from it, or if you want to use VMware or some other virtual machine thing, you set the CD-ROM to be this image file, and then it boots from the image file. 650,000 people have downloaded the image file, which is, 600 or 700 megabytes, so it's a fairly large download, and we've had this, more than 500,000 times in the last sort of 10 years, roughly. So there's apparently a lot of interest in it. We have a news group on Google. It was, the old, Usenet news group, and Google bought Usenet, and so there's a news group, and you can send, messages there, and people try to answer them and whatnot. So the conclusion is, I think current operating systems are kind of bloated and unreliable. It's an attempt to build a reliable and secure operating system from scratch. The kernel is very small, about 15,000 lines of code, which is like 14,000 lines of C, and there's maybe 1,000 lines of assembly code for the handling interrupts and setting up registers and stuff. The operating system actually runs as a collection of user processes. Every driver runs as a separate process. Each operating system component runs, you know, as a separate process, but the powers it has, privileges, are very restricted. It's not super user. It doesn't have access to the hardware's privileged instructions. It runs in user mode. It can't change its memory map, so it's very sandboxed. Faulty drivers can be replaced automatically. Things that have a lot of state, we're working on that, but we haven't really got that yet. It's harder. We can do the live update. It's not in the current release. We hope it'll be in the release fairly soon. We're working on that. But again, we've become open source, so it's a little trickier. We thought of running, you know, with all these people out there, we don't have as much of a community as we would like. So we're thinking of having a conference to try to bring people together. So we had a little poll on the website of who would come to a conference, and I don't know, about 70 people said, yeah, I'd come to a conference. We don't know if that's true or not, but, you know, so we're trying to build a community. We're scheduled a conference. It's on February 1st, which is Monday, the day after, you know, FOSDEM. FOSDEM is in Brussels, 2 days before that. So people going to FOSDEM in Brussels can come to Amsterdam from Brussels, you know, Sunday night and, you know, be there on time. Train takes about 2 to 3 hours. It's in Amsterdam, and everyone's invited, and you need to register, but that's on the website. So we're certainly looking for people to give talks, anything about MINIX or things related to MINIX are, you know, are open. So there's a link near the top of the page where you can find out about the conference and register, and we hope somebody will come and maybe give talks about MINIX. So we're very interested in trying to build a community. As an aside, if you're you know, an undergraduate student and you're looking for a master's in computer science, we have this really cool master's called Parallel and Distributed Computer Systems. It's research focused. Best way to find out it, just Google me, you find my homepage. There's a link on my homepage. And there's also a video there with me telling you all about the master's program, or you can go to pdcs.fu.nl. PDCS is Parallel and Distributed Computer Systems. But it's the simplest thing is Google me, and there's a link on my homepage. That's it. So I made it. So if there are any questions, I can try to answer them, but I can't see anything.
What's the actual performance impact of all the message passing?
We haven't really run with performance has never been a research issue for us, and the funding was all about research. There's certainly a hit. We don't know what it is. We do know that the L4 guys have put a tremendous amount of effort into performance of L4, and they've gotten the overhead down to about 5%. And so my assumption is if we really tried, which we haven't, it could be gotten down to something like maybe 5%. My guess is it's much more than that. But I don't know what it is because we've never really focused on that because the focus has been on reliability. But given how fast computers are now, if you had a 3 gigahertz machine and it performed like, you know, a 2 gigahertz machine or a 1 gigahertz machine, for an awful lot of things, that's enough. There are not many, you know, I mean, there's some high performance applications where it really matters. But if you're, you know, reading mail and surfing the web and doing compilations, even if it were, you know, 100% loss, that probably would be acceptable. I remember when I got my 60 megahertz Pentium 4, I was really happy. So I don't know what the loss is. There certainly is a loss, but and I don't think it's really that important right now. I don't know. Computers are very fast.
Can I run it on a virtual machine because it doesn't support...
Louder.
Can I run it in a virtual machine?
Yeah. You can. It works on VMware, and it works on VirtualBox, and so on. On the wiki, there are instructions for how to run it on a virtual machine. What about the Raspberry Pi?
We don't support it.
We don't support it, no. But it does work in virtual machines. It certainly works on VMware. It works on VirtualBox. I think it works on KVM. And on the wiki, there's a whole story about how to run it on virtual machines. But definitely works there, yeah.
Why did you choose the NetBSD package system? Why didn't you choose a Linux package system? Because they have more packages.
It's true, but they probably wouldn't work because the Linux has got a lot of stuff that, you know, is unfortunately fairly x86 specific. They're gradually changing that, you know, but for example, Linux won't compile with the LLVM compiler because there's a lot of x86 code inlined, okay? And there's a version of Linux for the LLVM compiler, but it doesn't work. We've tried it extensively. There are thousands and thousands of places where Linux does not conform to ANSI C, and only works with GCC because it's used GCC extensions. It's not written in ANSI C. NetBSD is written in ANSI C. It compiles with every C compiler. And so it was just too much trouble. And also, I mean, there's a lot of problems with the Linux code of exactly that form, which NetBSD doesn't have. They made a real effort for the portability. We're toast, but it's not very big, so it's not likely to die. In theory, we could have three reincarnation servers which checked each other to do triple modular redundancy, okay? So that would be a way out. But because the reincarnation server itself is fairly simple code, you know, it doesn't crash very often. I mean, you know, one bug per 1,000 lines of code, and the thing's only on 1,000 lines. There aren't a lot of bugs in it, but you could use triple modular redundancy to do it, but that makes it more complicated, which is more code, which I'm not sure that's a win, you know, on the whole.
So why did it take humankind so long to try to attempt to make a reliable one?
Because the guys at Carnegie Mellon wrote Mach in the early 80s, and Mach worked, but its performance wasn't very good, and they were talking about hoping for a 3M machine, that is, a machine which had 1 megahertz processor and 1 megabyte of memory and 1 megapixel on the screen, and that was a real reach. Not many computers had 1 megabyte of memory or a 1 megahertz processor, and so Mach didn't work very well because of the performance issues. And the word got out, microkernels are no good because the hardware was so slow then, and for 30 years people said microkernels are no good, and nobody has, you know, I mean, the L4 guys are doing a real effort to change that, but once the word gets out that something is no good, it's hard to change it, in the same way that the x86 architecture is kind of hard to change, and you know, there's a lot of things once they get entrenched. You know, the NTSC color television standard really isn't very good. The QWERTY keyboard, once something gets entrenched, it's very hard to change it. Doesn't say it can't happen. When I started computer science, Fortran was king. You know, but it took 30 years to get rid of Fortran. It's not really gone either.
Let's say someone wants to port Java to Minix. What should he expect? What is the reason? What is the complexity?
Well, we haven't looked at it, you know, because we don't have the manpower, basically. But I would think that first thing you need to look is what libraries does Java need to work. Port the libraries, which typically isn't very hard, but it's a certain amount of engineering effort of, you know, find out what the library is doing and are there any weird ioctals in it and what does the library want. Once you've ported all the libraries, assuming that the Java, you know, virtual machine program is written in ANSI standard C, which it may or may not be, then it should work easily. If it's written in GCC and it's got gazillion GCC extensions in it that LLVM doesn't support, there could be a problem. Although again, we do have GCC. It's not the default compiler, but we can handle GCC extensions. It's just, you know, more effort. So the libraries are the first thing. The question of whether you need kernel threads is an issue. If the Java virtual machine needs kernel threads, we don't have that. We do have user level threads. So those are the things that you'd need to look at. Okay. Thank you.